We are a social media friendly church, so let people know where you are and what you decide to do this Sunday morning. Throughout the service today, feel free to use whatever platform you're on to share anything that inspires you. Just remember to have your phone on silence, because only in silence can we hear God's voice. And if you are a guest or a first-time visitor here today, please know that here at Unity, we strongly believe this statement. Whoever you are, thank you for coming today. Reverend Mark's Rap with the Rev has been canceled and finished for the summer. It's gone on vacation, and it's going to return in the first Sunday in October, and that's an opportunity to sit down and talk with Mark after service from 11:30 to 12:30. So that's the next one's going to be October 6th. Enjoy your summer. Hopefully you'll be here with us, and if not, you can watch us on Facebook Live as well. So we'll see you in the fall. Now, the Way of Mastery started this past week on Wednesday night. It is a midweek spiritual gathering led by Mark, and it is on Facebook Live. And how many people watched it last week? All right, I watched it. It was great. I actually watched it while I was laying on the floor. It was just really, really, really comfortable. He said he was going to talk us right to sleep. So that's going to be every Wednesday night. It's 8 o'clock here in Florida. And it's an amazing time to explore the book, The Way of Mastery. It's available in the bookstore, and it's online. And if you didn't watch it, you can just go on to the Unity Facebook page. There's a link on there. Put in your name and your email address, and they will set you up so that you can watch it as well. It's very, very, very easy to do. And hopefully you can join us every Wednesday night and Mark as well. And the book is available in the higher grounds. Now, starting this week on Wednesday, June 5th, Linda Collins, right over here, is going to have a crystal bowl healing service once a month here in the sanctuary at 6:30. It employs the vibrations of crystal bowls, which cause deep levels of relaxation and healing. And it's offered on a love offering basis of $15. Join us on Wednesday night for that. And at this time, I'd like you to all stand up and shake a hand, give a hug, and tell them that you're in love with Unity of Naples.
All right, grab your last hug and then join me as we begin to settle in for our meditation. And as our singers go, oh yeah, we have to be up there now. Take a nice deep breath. Open your hands if that's comfortable for you, feet on the floor. I always like to lift my chin up a little bit to create space for my heart and my throat chakra to just open and receive. Breathe in through your nose. Exhale through your mouth. Feel free to stay inside with your eyes closed if that's comfortable, or if you'd like to sing our little opening verse to center us more, feel free to join us in that peace. This exhale, really feel the body relax. Invite the mind to become calm. And on this weekend of Pride, take a moment for yourself and allow the most positive feeling of pride to rise up within you. Because truly, you are so much more than the stories you tell about yourself. God has worked mightily through you. Be proud of the gifts and talents that you've been given. Be proud of exactly who you are, where you are. Know that there is a divine presence. Some call this presence Mother, Father, God. This presence feels enormous pride that you are its wonderful creation, that you are the child of this love, and that you extend this love in your world. Allow your attention to drop into your heart. And if there's anything heavy on your heart, take this moment to offer it up. Give it to the Holy Spirit. You can simply say, "Hey, I can't figure this out. Please take this." Or, "This isn't even mine to do. Please take this." Or, "I'm willing to be so loved that I don't even have to figure it out or do it. Please take this." You don't need to carry any burden. Give it over in this moment. Whatever's been capturing your mind and your energy, causing you to worry or fear, give it over. Give it up. God can solve it. God will take care of you if you get out of the way. No more fighting. No more figuring out. God is your source. And finally, imagine your mind opening wide, your heart opening even wider to receive the perfect message and the miracles that are here for you today. This entire experience has been created just for you. Take a deep breath. Feel free to stay in this meditation or join us as we move into the singing of the Lord's Prayer.
Our Father, which art in Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debt.
Today we have a very special presentation for you. We have members of our community sharing their stories of being a part of the LGBTQ world, how it has changed their lives, and how it's a part of their spiritual path. So please open your minds and heart to love and receive this wonderful group.
Good morning. Throughout my years as an openly gay man, I have often been asked by my friends and family, when did you know you were gay? That's always a tough question. I didn't know the term homosexual until I reached my high school years. But the one thing that I always knew as a child growing up in small town Indiana is the feelings and thoughts that I had were different from others. They also felt wrong and forbidden. No one specifically told me they were, but the images and messages I received as a young boy were completely contradictory to the feelings I had inside. I learned at a young age that if I wanted to express myself honestly, I had to do so privately and secretly. While other boys in the neighborhood were off playing cowboys and Indians, I was sneaking off to play Mary Poppins. I loved that Mary could glide to the earth with her magical umbrella and trusted I could do the same. One day when I was alone, I grabbed my mother's favorite umbrella, climbed the large maple tree in our front yard. When I got to the top, I popped open the umbrella and attempted to float to the ground just like Mary Poppins. Well, that didn't quite work out the same way. I ended up hiding my mother's umbrella and ultimately lying to my parents about the scrapes on my knees and the limp I had when I was walking. I told them I was playing army with my friends and that my wounds were a result of our make-believe battles. Another time, my parents were out for an evening, and I snuck into my mother's bedroom to grab her long black satin silk gloves. I loved the look and feel of those gloves. I would stand in front of their full-length mirror and admire how pretty they looked on my young hands and arms. In my mind, I was Miss Indiana, or better yet, Miss America. On one particular evening, as I was waving to my throng of adoring fans as I walked the runway in Atlantic City, I heard a shuffle behind me. I turned around quickly to see both of my parents staring at me in total disbelief. My father looked at me and said with total disgust, "What in the hell are you doing?" In that moment, nothing short of a divine intervention happened. I raised my satin glove fist in the air and I shouted, "To the Bat Cave, Robin!" Furthermore, I whisked my imaginary cape and ran out of the room, leaving my parents in a state of total shock and confusion. I bolted to my bedroom and I slammed my bedroom door shut. My feelings of embarrassment and shame were so profound that all I could do was throw myself onto the bed, into my pillow, so that my parents would not hear me sobbing. They never came to my room that night, and the incident was never discussed again. In retrospect, I guess I knew I was a gay man at a young age, and as challenging as that might have been, what remains paramount for me today is the sadness I feel when I think of how much of my life was spent living in a series of secret lies and secrets. Those secrets and lies led me to feelings of remorse, guilt, shame, self-doubt, self-destruction. For years, multiple addictions ruled my life, and it has taken a lot of work to create and define who I honestly am today. I am fortunate in this that I never ever felt I was deserted or abandoned by God because I was a gay man or because I was not living a truthful life. I always knew there was a God protecting me. I just didn't take the time nor do the work to honor the divine presence that is in me and that is in all of you. Today, I have a wonder-filled, sober life with a loving family, caring friends, emotional abundance I never thought possible. Part of my recovery from a dishonest life was finding a spiritual home that would allow me to be my authentic self and allow me to grow spiritually. I have found that spiritual home here in this amazing community called Unity Naples. I am Brett Marsden, and I stand before you today as an out, proud, and honest gay man.
Boy, that's a hard story to follow. Thanks, Brett. Good morning. My name is Patsy Gordon, and I am the proud mother of a gay son. I first suspected my son was gay when he started working in a gay bar in Chicago. My friends and I used to visit him at the bar because it was a great place to hang out. People were happy. It was a festive environment, and my friends and I used to love to dance. I tried to ask my son if he was gay during that time, telling him that it was perfectly acceptable to me if he was, but he kept denying or avoiding the subject. He said he simply worked at the bar because he was helping out a friend. Then I realized my son had been addicted to drugs. At that point, his sexual orientation was the least of my concerns. As a mother, all I was focused on was keeping my son alive. Everything paled in comparison to the idea of losing my son to drugs. That was a challenging time for me, but at the end of the day, we got through it. I believe my son turned to drugs to deal with the pain and shame that I know now so many people, gay people struggle with. My son did eventually come out to me and tell me he was gay. That was not a problem for me, but I did experience a great sense of loss. The loss of a traditional family, the loss of not being a grandmother, and the loss of what I thought would be a happy life for him. But how wrong I was for thinking that. For today, he has a loving and adoring partner whom I love, and I do have a wonderful grandson who he adopted when he was 8 and is now 37 years old. And a beautiful young man. My son is also experiencing success in his career, and I love the family we have all come together to be. My faith, my strong belief in God, my family, my friends, and my church have all been a part of me and my understanding of what love really is. It gives me great joy to stand before you today to proclaim I am the proud mother of a homosexual son.
I'll sit back there for all eternity, but standing up here, terrifying. And on a pedestal. Who made that decision? I was not consulted. Growing up, I was told I was a boy. I hated it. I knew I was a girl by the age of 8, as soon as I learned that not everyone felt like an alien in their own body. But I grew up in a very religious, conservative, homeschooled family, so transgender wasn't even in our vocabulary. Everyone assumed I was just a little gay boy, so they were relieved when I told them I wasn't, even though I still didn't tell them the truth. Not only was I concerned with my parents condemning me to hellfire, but I stayed hidden for years because the first time I did tell someone was horrifyingly traumatic. I was 13 and at a soccer camp. I was in my dorm room, and after a day of running around with a bunch of sweaty boys and feeling as uncomfortable in my body as ever, I lay in bed and my older roommate began making increasingly graphic sex jokes. For some reason, I broke. I couldn't take this abrupt confrontation of my own biology, so I burst out telling him to stop. He laughed. Why? After a few more rounds of this, stop, why, stop, why? I told him what I had not told anyone. I'm a girl trapped in a boy's body. I don't know why I chose that moment to say those words. I had only practiced saying them to myself every time I looked in a mirror, but it seemed to work. Silence. And then sleep, and then not. When I woke up, sometime later, It was to the forceful grip on my wrists and neck, the harsh hands over my mouth, and the muffled thrusting of several bodies on top of me. I couldn't even comprehend what was happening to me. I remember crying, I remember squirming, I remember my body feeling things it had never felt. But mostly, I just remember watching the oscillating fan hum back and forth, trying in vain to keep my body cool. And his voice. Do you feel like a girl now? After that, I became quite detached. I had been told that the way I experience the world is wrong and will get me hurt. I tried to block out every thought, feeling, and memory that made me feel vulnerable. I became scared of the world and everything in it because it was irreconcilable with my perception of it. I was scared to upset anyone, scared to be alone, scared of my own desires, ideas, dreams. And I became petrified of being touched. Not only would it remind me of my alien body, but it would send me back inside that dorm room. I didn't tell anyone for years until I told my then best friend, now wife, Emily. And with her help, I began seeking counseling, medical treatments, and finally, last year, hormone replacement therapy. I have been living as a woman, my correct gender, openly, over that time, and have never felt more at peace, happy, and comfortable. For many trans folks, including myself, unlike many other LGBTQ identities, we long for that part of identity to go unnoticed. We long to be able to just live as our correct gender and to be seen as such by the world around us. So I agreed to talk today, not to draw attention to my identity or to represent the T in LGBTQ+, but to raise awareness of how the trans experience is a human experience and as a representative of the T that helps us spell humanity. Growing up, I was told I was a boy and I hated it. Now I tell people I'm a woman and I love it.
My name is Eileen Chernow, and I am a proud sister of a gay brother. Jason's fourth Christmas, it's a real memory to me. He got a Lone Ranger pistol, and my sister got an Easy Bake Oven. He dove to the Easy Bake Oven, paid no attention to the pistol, and started baking for us whenever he could. He used to like to wear my sister's skirt, and he would dance all around the house. And honestly, we thought nothing of it. We thought he was just so happy. He was gay, but you know, we didn't use that term then. And he was just a gay guy, just happy in his life, until he went to school. When he went to school, everything changed, and as he got older in school, we knew how much he was teased and bullied. He had so much stress in his life that he was hiding, that he wasn't even free with us anymore. It was like he was a nobody. When he was in high school, he actually had a bleeding ulcer and had to have surgery because of all the stress he was under. When he was in his early 20s, he had been taking piano and organ lessons, and he started playing the piano in the Catholic Church, and the organ, I should say. And whenever they needed him on a Sunday, he would play, or for a funeral or whatever, he would play for them. And that made him feel like he was somebody, that he could make a difference, until he came out in his late 20s. He trusted somebody in the church that he thought he could tell. And that was the beginning of the end for him. He was not allowed in the church anymore. He wasn't allowed to play the organ. He was actually ostracized from the church. And that was the end for him, for understanding who God was and could be. He was HIV positive in the late 80s, pretty far into it at that point, and knew that there wasn't much hope for him, so he did experimental drugs to help find a cure for AIDS. And I remember him saying to me, I know this isn't going to help me, but it's the least I can do for humanity is to keep doing this. He would have sores on his legs, on his face, on his arms, because these drugs were so toxic. His face sometimes would be orange. I mean, it was awful to see as a sister, you know? And it broke my mother's heart to see him like that. And he became full-blown AIDS in 1995. Now, he lived in Tampa, Florida. We lived in New Jersey. He came to see us in his car, drove all that way with a fever, saying his goodbye to all of us without us realizing it in that moment. Spent a few days with each one of us and took his car and went back. I was so worried about him. I made sure he got back all right. He was home one day, and then I got a call from somebody, "Your brother is in intensive care." I got on a plane and I went immediately. When I got there, visiting hours were just over, but there was a door with a window, and I could see that his bed was straight ahead, and I could see that they were tying him down. And I banged and banged on that door until somebody heard me. It was the nurse, and he actually said, "What's up?" I said, "That's my brother. I just got here from New Jersey. I have to see him, and you're not going to tie him down. You don't want to push a sister, you know." He let me in, and I said, "What needs to happen so that he is not tied down? I do not want my brother to die tied in a bed." He got it. He said to me, "If you're willing to stay here with him the whole time, I won't tie him down, but he's hallucinating. His heart is racing, and until it gives out, he's going to keep racing, and he's going to keep hallucinating. Your job is to remind him where he is." I said, "Okay, I'll do that." You know, it's amazing how you don't need to go to the bathroom or eat. It all goes away because you're so focused on being with that person that you love so much. Well, he went through a whole bunch of things. Some of the things were he was hallucinating that I was coming to visit him with the kids and he needed to clean the house. Then he was, and that was fun. I kind of laughed at that. I didn't realize he would get uptight about that. And then he went into a place where he started naming people and asking for forgiveness for what he may have done to them. It was an incredible experience. I have to add that because we were raised Catholic, my mother gave me a direct order, and that was that a Catholic priest needed to anoint him. Well, you don't argue with an 82-year-old mother. So I said, okay. So I asked for the priest to come in, and I stood at the doorway with him, and I told him the story and how he was ostracized from the church and the whole thing. The priest said, "Leave it to me." He came in. I stood at the foot of the bed, and he said to my brother, "Jason, I am so sorry for what the Catholic Church has done to you all these years. Can you ever forgive us for this? Can you forgive us? I am representing the entire Catholic Church right now to ask for your forgiveness." And he honestly was lying in that bed and he said, "I forgive you, Father. And I forgive the church." I mean, I was crying my eyes out at that point. And the priest, he said, "Now may I pray with you and anoint you?" And he said, "Father, I've always needed prayers." I'll never forget him saying that. And he prayed with him, he anointed him, and then he bent over and kissed his head. And then he gave me a hug at the end and said how sorry he was. And I forgot to tell you, they wanted me to be all done up with a mask on and everything, and I refused to do it. And then the priest bends and kisses his head. I said, "Yeah, see? We don't need that stuff. We don't need it." After that, my brother became very quiet. After all, his heart had been racing for hours and hours and hours, and he got into a fetal position. I asked him if I could fluff his pillow for him, and he said yes. They came in and turned off all the bells and whistles so that he could just go peacefully without any kind of noises. And when I realized he was almost going to be leaving this planet, I bent over and I started telling him how much I loved him and how much I cared about him. And then I said, please don't forget us when you get to the other side. Oh, please don't forget us. Do you hear me? I was in giving a last order to him. I was the older sister, you know. Do you hear me? Do not forget us when you get to the other side. You know, to this day, my children and my grandchildren, his nieces and nephews and great nieces and nephews have a picture of him in their houses. He was absolutely wonderful, wonderful brother. I am so proud. So proud after 29 years, I think that was the right number, to be a sister of a gay brother. He taught me so much in my life. Thank you.
Well, going last in this little line is incredibly difficult. Good morning. My name is Lynn. I appreciate the opportunity to tell you just a bit about my story, and I promise to you, as my friends and family will remind me, I can get a bit chatty, so I promise this is just a bit of my story. I grew up in the real-life equivalent of my big fat Greek wedding, except we equivalently called ourselves the big, loud Irish Catholic family. We did everything together. We had fish fries, not just during Lent, but year-round on Friday. Growing up Catholic, my visual of God was a big disciplinarian in the sky that had a giant book with my name on one of the pages, and everything I did good went in one column, and everything I did bad went in another column. And on my last breath of life, as long as I had more good things in the good column than the bad column, well, that was the better option. In my Irish Catholic family, I never once heard anybody speak poorly about gay people. I never heard anybody speak about gay people at all. But growing up in the Catholic Church, I didn't really get a real warm fuzzy about the topic either. I never entertained the fact growing up that I could possibly be gay. It wasn't okay. So it wasn't going to go in the bad column of my book. Well, I grew up, I left home, I had the college experience, I joined a campus ministry there where I found a more loving God. I was a missionary for a fundamentalist Christian mission to people with physical and mental challenges. I graduated, I got a job. I was living the normal life. At this job, I lived there. I lived on campus. It was a residential school and home for people with mental disabilities. And they had every cable channel under the face of the moon in these rooms. And I'm flipping through the channels one night after I got off, and I flipped to a channel, and it is two women being intimate. And my curiosity was piqued. And I immediately changed the channel, squashed that thought, and never thought about it again. At least I tried not to. I dated here and there, yes, guys, but nothing ever serious. Life went on, moved to Florida, I turned 30. My coworkers had an excellent party for me. I was happy, and on the night of my 30th birthday party, I had maybe had more than one drink, or 10. So I was unable to drive myself home from Chili's that night. It was fun, it's cheap. And this woman that was at my party, who happened to also work for me, drove me home and consequently picked me up and took me to work the next day. We started hanging out. We started talking. Then, I tell you, the craziest, most ridiculous feeling came over me. I fell in love with this woman. I wasn't seeking love, but I fell in love with a woman. I had never considered that I was gay. Never. But here I was 30, and I was in love. And man, that was a crazy feeling. I had planned a vacation, and Jamie was going to watch my house and my dog for me. And I pulled away, and I drove about 50 miles north as I was on my way to Mississippi. I pulled off an exit, I sat in a parking lot, I cried, and I went back south. I couldn't leave her. I was that much in love. So after much wrestling and grappling and being kicked out of a church, having Jamie's best friend ditch her like a bad habit, here we are. We found a church that accepts us for who we are. She carried our twins. Soon after it was legal to get married, we were married. And very soon after that, we took all of our wedding money and I adopted our 2 5-year-olds. I can now say that I am proud to be gay because I allowed myself to accept the gift that God had prepared for me. I opened my heart and I said, thank you. And so to you, Unity, I say thank you. I say thank you. We are so happy that our kids have a place where they can learn how to worship. That we can have a place where we can worship, we can learn, we can laugh, we can cry, we can celebrate right alongside of you, just as we are. Thank you.
Today to make you feel proud. It's never could be so many people if you make that break for freedom. What have you done today to make you feel proud? What have you done today to make you feel proud? Yeah! What have you done today to make you feel proud? Make you feel proud.
Oh, thank you all so much. Please give an extra round of applause for these amazing people that shared their stories with you. Thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you. There's nothing like learning about the people that you're sitting right next to and their story. It's so healing. Thank you. We're going to move into some prayer, and this is a prayer for the world, because as tough as it can be for anyone who's a minority in our culture sometimes, around the world, LGBTQ people are still being persecuted in countries. There's great strides taken here, but in other parts of the world, it's absolutely impossible for people to be who they are, many times the result of religion. So let's do a special prayer this evening, and please join me. Let us be a light here for those who are in need, and let us be a light for the world. Take a deep breath. God is the healing light. God is the presence and power that excludes no one. It doesn't even know the word. God is perfect love, only love, unconditioned love. And that love is everyone, everywhere, absolutely. And there is no life that is wrong. There is no life that is wrong in God. At the deepest of every being is the perfection of being. And for those that don't know it, for those who can't be it, for those who can't allow it in the world, we are the light. We are the light. We are the place where people can remember, can become, can awaken, can heal. Right here, Unity Naples. We are the light. And our light goes far beyond our walls as we imagine it circling the entire globe. Specifically on this day for the LGBTQ world, but also for all minorities, all people who are suffering from feeling other than perfect. Man, woman, race, identity, gender, culture, religion. Anywhere where someone feels disenfranchised, not a part of that light because of who they are. We send them our prayers, we send them our love because we are one with them. We are one with all. Take a deep breath.
I am not the mistakes that I have made, or any of the things that cause me pain. I am not the piece of the dream that I have left behind. I am light.
Yes. Sing along.
I am light. I am light. I am light. I am light.
From your heart.
I am light. I am light.
Sing along.
I am light. I am light.
your heart, sing. One more time.
I am light, I am light.
Quiet, just spread that light. And so it is. Amen. Amen. Beautiful. Thank you. Thank you, amazing singers. Thank you. And now is your opportunity to share your gift with this beautiful community. I invite our ushers and greeters to come forward as you take a moment to bless the gift that you bring. Know that the gift that you give allows us to spread this light farther and farther and farther. For we are very blessed to be sitting in these seats today. And there are those that don't know these seats are here for them. Those that need these seats and want these seats. So you give to help us shine this light brighter. That's what your gifts are for today. Together we say, divine love through me blesses and multiplies all that I am, all that I have, all that I give, and all that I receive. Thank you so much. Thank you. If you'd like to do text to give, it's very simple. You put this number, 239-230-4704. Put that in the top section of your chat. Then go to the next slide, and you simply write the word give right there in the chat box. Write the word give, and then push the button send. And that's how you can activate giving via your phone. It's a great way to give to us. It's a great way to help us because it goes right into our accounts, right into our QuickBooks, saves us time, energy in doing it. It goes right in. So thank you for those of you who are choosing that. Thank you so much for the live streamers today and for all your contributions. We appreciate you also so much.
God is my source. God is my power. God gives me everything I need. So I give thanks for all my blessings. God gives me everything I need.
Love
is my source. Love is my power. Love gives me everything I need. So I give thanks for all my blessings. Love gives me
Join me in taking a moment and blessing these gifts, thanking Sweet Spirit for the overflow from which this love is given. This is love giving to love, expanding love. And I know that the gift and the giver are one and the same, and that we all are infinitely blessed, grateful, and so it is. Amen.
Amen.
So it's summertime here, and we've got lots of empty seats, so it's a great time for you to invite your friends and family to come check us out. Let's spread some unity love. We have some great things coming up. Starting next week, we have a series on metaphysical Bible interpretation. And I'm going to show you exactly how we do. I'm going to take some stories each week and break them down so you can really have a new relationship with these stories. And then in July into August, we move into Your Most Magnificent Life, studying the chakras, the seven chakras, lining them up with teachings in the Bible, the mystical, the unity teaching. It's all in there. So we've got a wonderful summer for you and for you to bring your friends and family to. So a couple other things. Thank you so much to the Unity Players, the improv show that was Thursday night. You were amazing. It was so much fun, and so much fun that Patrick's going to be teaching another fun workshop this coming Saturday on June the 8th. So if you didn't get a chance to ever experience what it's like to do improv and just have some fun play in The Power of Now, the book by Eckhart Tolle, that's coming up this Saturday. He'll be out at the registration table to learn more about that. Couple other things. Levi Christ, a good friend of mine, a Tony Award winner, is going to be here next Sunday doing the music and doing an unbelievable concert in the afternoon. You must mark that off and bring your friends. Here's a message from Levi.
Hey everybody, this is Levi Christ. I cannot wait to sing for you guys next Sunday, June 9th. A very special Pride Week inspired performance called Liberated, where I take you through my life from drug addiction to 10 years sobriety as of yesterday, and my journey of self-love and spiritual enlightenment. It's going to be a great time. I can't wait to see you. So be there June 9th, 4 o'clock. See you then.
So please be sure to come for that. The cafe bookstore will be open beforehand for you to have some food, some drink, some fellowship before the concert. New member class also begins next Saturday, so if you haven't signed up for that yet, please do at the registration table. It's a brand new class, and if you've been a member forever, this is an opportunity for you to renew that membership. So please don't think this is just for new people. We want everyone to renew and become new in our intention and in our new vision. We have a Unity Town Hall meeting. Last week was wonderful with the Q&A, and when we sorted through the questions, there were a lot of questions about what's happening at Unity, what's the vision for. One of them was, Mark, are you gay? Just ask Patrick on that one. But you asked very important questions, and so you said to me, oh my gosh, we've got to have more conversation. So Sunday the 16th, for 1 hour, I know it's Father's Day, but 1 hour after service, we're going to entertain your questions and share about the vision, share with what's coming up so that you feel connected, you feel a part of it, and you feel good. So please join me for that, and is that it for me? That's it for me. Come on back up.
Thank you, Mark. I've been a member here a long time. I've never been prouder to be a member of a church than I am today. Thank you. Standing up in front of a group of your peers and telling your truth, your deep, honest truth, is one of the hardest things that anybody will ever do, and to stand here and do that and be received in love. We blessed all five that were on stage today. Thank you so much for sharing with us. We just have a couple of quick announcements, and we have the kids in here. We'd like to welcome any visitors or newcomers that are here for today. If it's your first day, you picked a whopper. just saying. If you're comfortable, please stand up, and the ushers will bring you a flower and an information card. If you're comfortable, stand up. We'd love to welcome you. Anybody here for the first time? Yes, there's some people right here. Thank you very much. All right. And you bring the little card. There's a table over there. It's got some blue tables in the front. It's our welcome center. Yep, just hold your hand up there. The Welcome Center's in the courtyard. Just go over there and they'll give you a little gift and answer any of your questions. We'd be happy to talk to you about our Unity experience. And just a reminder that we never want anyone to leave here without receiving prayer support. If you'd like prayer, please make your way to the front of the service, front of the sanctuary after service. Just sit in the front row, and a prayer chaplain and team member will be assist you. They'll pray for anything that you like. Now, this is the Unity Silent Prayer number, and it's called 1-800-NOW-PRAY. And I realized I should probably have this in my phone all the time. I had a lady come up to me after church and said, "Why don't we have a prayer line?" And I said, "We do," but I didn't have the information to give to her. So take this down, put it in your phone, and if somebody needs some support, that is manned up in Kansas City 24 hours a day. So the Unity Silence of Prayer, you can see it right behind me. I won't even try to say it. 1-800-669-7729. Put that in your phones. Newcomers, please don't forget to stop by the Welcome Center. I said that. Children are in the back. They're ready to rock it on down. So they're playing too. They're moving to New Soul by a name that I can't say because I'm over 50 years old. And Penelope picked it. So I won't even try to say y'all names. So all right, kids, come on down. Thanks for being here.
Of Naples. Today we begin our journey into the chakras. So we learned about our root chakra, color red. That's the energy that helps us stay safe and secure. And we did a variety of different things in each class. I have no one to share. So, so we just wanted to share. I'm sharing. Thank you.
Thank you for being here today. Thank you for being a part of this love fest. Please stand and let us sing together our closing song, "Let There Be Peace on Earth."